300 years ago, the grand founder of the ancient assembly whispered in a voice that everyone heard and said, "For the establishment of the temple and the imposition of the one system, there must be 3 world wars." He said it literally, but the people of yesterday are like the people of today. They don't see the events until it's too late. For whoever sees the light in the darkness knows that the direct goal of igniting the First World War was the destruction of the 4 empires. The German Tsarism, the Austro-Hungarian, the Slavic Bolshevik, and finally the Islamic Ottoman. In order to establish the rule of the Illuminati and impose it on the world under the British-American umbrella. The discerning also knows that the goal of igniting the Second World War was to acquiesce and weaken Europe and the Soviets, and to establish the most powerful unipolar that will rule the world with iron and fire. Today, when Uncle Sam's empire is on the verge of collapse due to debts and internal division on the one hand, and the growing powers of the East on the other, it was necessary to shake off the ashes by rewriting yesterday's scenario with the pen of the present and igniting the Great War again. Why does China want to restore Taiwan after 70 years of independence? A question that everyone asks, but the more accurate question is, how was America able to make Taiwan a direct escape port for China? What's the real purpose of fattening Taiwan before offering it as a sacrifice to the fuse of war? But what's the goal behind spreading strife and disputes among neighboring countries, although the fire will burn everyone? We will present to you a sequential analysis of the facts in order to link the events and to know the details of the most dangerous Sino-American game that will precede the outbreak of the Great War and plunge the world into a deep tunnel. To understand the current reality in depth, we must first understand Uncle Sam's political orientation related to wars. Although the USA is about 250 years old, it has spent 222 years in wars, including more than 90 wars so far. So, the first political orientation of Uncle Sam's empire is wars, for 4 main goals that do not change, which are expansion, the economy represented in resources, getting rid of debts, and finally weakening the competing forces. After the USA was established on the arms of the grandchildren of John Calvin, it adopted a single style in its war policy, which is fighting behind walls. In the First World War, it entered in the last months, but it reaped all the spoils. In the Second War, Europe and the Soviets were put in the forefront, and the US was from behind, so it was the real winner and dominated the world. On the few occasions that it felt that it was able to move its army, it incurred very great losses and defeats in Vietnam, Afghanistan, and finally Iraq, which it didn't enter until after the destruction of its military arsenal. However, it couldn't occupy it by its own strength, but rather by betrayals. On this page of history, we clearly see that Uncle Sam's second political orientation in wars is based on proxy war, pending the exhaustion of the enemy until direct entry, in order to avoid the experience of Vietnam and Afghanistan. As for the third and most dangerous orientation, it's to sow strife and ignite wars among neighboring countries in order to achieve absolute sovereignty and weaken the direct and potential opponents. In the last century, it supported South Korea at the expense of the Northern one, and at the same time, gave the green light to North Korea to be armed in order to ignite tension between the two. It also planted the focus of tension between India and Pakistan over the Kashmir region, and supported India at the expense of Pakistan. In 1979, it supported the jihadists in order to fight the Soviets with the lives of the Islamists and to get rid of them both. And after 10 years, it succeeded in toppling the Soviets and launched an all-out war against the Mujahideen who had the direct credit for the Soviets' downfall. And the war remained on Islam until 2008, the year in which the US budget reached a deficit. It was necessary to trigger the global economic crisis to get rid of the deficit and debts.
Not in generations has Wall Street absorbed the number of body blows it took today.
The American financial system is rocked to its foundation as top Wall Street institutions topple under a mountain of debt.
When you step back for just a moment and consider the events of the last few days, it is truly unbelievable.
During its fierce war against Islam, it gave a golden opportunity for the emergence of a great power in the East under the banner of China and Russia, and the transformation of the global economy to the Red Army. And as a result of the economic crisis that it triggered in 2008, China and Russia have come to learn that America is on the verge of collapse and wants to get rid of the major economic and military powers. Just like the Second World War game, which will give it rise again. By triggering the economic crisis, it will delay what comes next and will give it a new lung to breathe. However, this time China and Russia had a different role and a game that Uncle Sam's country didn't expect. After America created the global economy crisis in 2008, China and Russia established a global organization called BRICS, which aims to establish a bipolar world order led by each of them. This step will be one of the causes of the Third World War, which its first flame was ignited in that year, 14 years ago. The first top-level meeting of the leaders of the BRICS countries was held in July 2008 on the Japanese island of Hokkaido, where the G8 summit met, which was joined by Brazil, India, and finally South Africa. And today, Russia's trying to persuade Saudi Arabia and Egypt to also join that organization. But this won't happen until the collapse of America is confirmed. The establishment of this organization was an alarm bell for the American administration, as it includes 40% of the population of Earth and is expected to take over the global economy with an iron fist. Therefore, America changed its war strategy from a war on Islam to a war against the leaders of the BRICS organization, Russia and China. In 2010, Uncle Sam began to stir things up, and protests began in Ukraine calling for independence and sovereignty. These events continued for 4 years, between escalation and tension, until 2014, the former Ukrainian president, loyal to the Russian leadership, was dismissed, and a new president, Volodymyr Zelensky, of Jewish origin, was appointed. And then, the second game began with the deployment of NATO forces around Russia and the announcement of the intention to include Ukraine in NATO. Russia since 1991, that is after the fall of the Soviet Union, had fears of the expansion of NATO, especially since it included all the countries of the former Union to it, except for Ukraine, which made Russia all this time cautious with the expansion. In 2020, Zelensky's speech further inflamed tension with Russia, and it was only 1 year later that a draft resolution to include Ukraine in the Western alliance was put forward.
If Ukraine will be in NATO and by military means will return to Crimea, European countries will automatically be drawn into a military conflict with Russia.
And Russia has become surrounded by NATO forces. The immediate goal of these escalations was to drag Russia into the Ukrainian quagmire, even if it avoided the clash, the loss of Ukraine from its hand and the siege of NATO would leave it only one way, either progress or retreat and contraction. On the other hand, Uncle Sam played cleverly to show Ukraine fragile and devoid of weapons and force by repeatedly declaring the necessity of America to arm it. But at the same time, orders were issued to European countries to declare their neutrality and to avoid confrontation with Russia. All these plays are in order to give the Russians the green light to move forward. And when the war began, military aid and heavy weapons poured down on Ukraine, without Europe realizing that America had entangled it in a war from which it wouldn't survive. And today, the world is witnessing cutting off the Russian gas from Europe and its entry into the dark era soon. However, Uncle Sam achieved two goals together, the first by drowning the Russians and the second by weakening Europe, in order to accelerate the pace of destroying the old order, which will explain its dangerous purpose later in this documentary. And here, the arena has become empty to turn towards China, the economic rival and biggest nightmare. What we will reveal to you now shows that the plan to overthrow the Russian-Chinese forces was written on one page using the same scenario. In 2016, 2 years after the ouster of the former Ukrainian president, Taiwan's pro-Chinese presidency was dismissed and handed over to Tsai Ing-wen, a left-wing woman submissive to America, belongs to the DPP that tends to separate and independence from China. And here, the first fuse began to ignite tension between the two countries, in exactly the same manner that was applied against the Russians. And within 4 years, the tension increased dramatically and came close to an explosion. But the dagger that strongly stabbed China's back was represented in the American sanctions that were imposed on it after its union with the Russians. These sanctions weren't traditional, but were of a new type represented in preventing China from obtaining electronic chips, which are the nucleus of technology and the basic element in any electronic device, mechanical or even military. And the fact is that the largest plant for manufacturing these chips is located in Taiwan. And here was the decisive blow. With a direct order from America, Taiwan stopped supplying China with its needs of these segments. This means that after a few years, China will enter the semiconductor crisis, which means stopping the technical production at all levels, including the military one. The question that comes to mind is, what is the importance of that plant, which may also be involved in the causes of the Great War? In the 50s of the last century, Taiwan was a very poor country, depending on agriculture. But only after half a century it turned into an industrial country that affects the smallest details of our lives and even confuses decision makers in the largest countries in the world. The secret to this boom was the plant of electronic chips or semiconductors. In order to understand how one plant can affect everything in your modern life, you must know the diversity of the products it produces, as 12,302 products come out of it, which are used to manufacture all the technologies you see around you, from phone chips to aircraft engines, and chips for high-end weapons. Also, the Taiwanese Semiconductor Manufacturing Company, aka TSMC, accounts for 53% of the whole world's production of electronic chips, as it's contributed to raising the country's GDP in 2020 to $800 billion, while in the 70s it didn't exceed $15 billion only. Can you imagine the amount of money and technical progress that China will get as a result of annexing that island? I think now you understand why China is interested in acquiring Taiwan. This plant is priceless, and China doesn't have the technology that it possesses. It was able to produce chips with a standard of up to 5 nanometers only, and every million nanometers equals only 1 centimeter. So can you imagine the size of the architecture by 5 nanometers? This outperforms Intel chips, allowing the manufacture of small chips enough to store the data of an entire country, as well as access to high-speed computer processors for military use or scientific research. Taiwan is now studying the production of chips less than 1 nanometer, and if it succeeds in this, it will generate an unparalleled scientific breakthrough. And here the question arises, how can America sacrifice this economic and technological revolution in order to drown China in the quagmire of Taiwan? The simple answer is, America will not sacrifice anything. At the beginning of this year, the White House instructed Taiwan to dismantle the plant and transfer it to America. And if this step was taken by Taiwan, it would be like stepping into hell, because this plant is the only guarantee for the continuation of the American support. And America wants to transfer the plant to it before dragging China into the quagmire of Taiwan. Mark Liu, the chairman of TSMC, stated in an interview with CNN, "Nobody can control TSMC by force. If you take a military force or invasion, you will render TSMC factories inoperable." And he explained, "Because these are such sophisticated manufacturing facilities, they depend on the real-time connection with the outside world." And a while ago, plant experts and scientists in the development department were transferred to America after the House of Representatives passed the CHIPS and Science Act to build a Taiwanese chip plant on US soil. Here, America escalated the threat against China to encourage it more to enter Taiwan before it's too late. However, China is completely unable to take this step because of its dangerous consequences. China tried to solve the problem diplomatically, but to no avail, although it knows very well that the real issue is to deal a severe hit to its military technology industries department. And here, it has no choice but to annex the Taiwanese island. China began to launch military threats to annex the island by force, so the allies in Japan, South Korea, Malaysia, and Singapore were on standby, and these countries became like a wall that surrounds China. If China was to enter Taiwan, this would be a major hit to it. So it resorts to the economic war method against America by using the epidemic method on the one hand and by besieging the island on the other. Now America knows that China is around the corner from moving towards the goal. And even if it doesn't move, sanctions and blockades are imposed on it from all directions. But the Chinese are also good at playing this game, as no one can ignore that it controls the goods in the world, and this economic power will be used against the Americans. By putting pressure on the US economy on the one hand, and besieging Taiwan on the other, it's teetering on a fragile rope that may break at any moment. And here Uncle Sam moved towards the biggest and most dangerous step. Some time ago, the third most powerful figure in America and the Speaker of the US House of Representatives, Nancy Pelosi, announced her intention to visit Taiwan and justified the visit with the aim of supporting and standing beside the United States allies. And only days later, the US Department of Defense asked her to cancel that visit after China's threats to shoot down the plane. The purpose of announcing the visit and then canceling it was to give the Chinese the green light to move forward towards Taiwan. However, the Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesman expressed that China is trying to impose peaceful solutions first with Taiwan, so the Americans knew that China understands well the American game. In an unprecedented manner, Nancy confirmed her visit to Taiwan in order to achieve two goals. The first goal is to slap China in front of the world and to show it as weak and defeated, especially in front of its own people. And the second goal is to madly provoke China and impose American sovereignty. For America knows that China never dares to shoot down the American plane, and even if it does, then it will give the world the perfect excuse to its own destruction. At the beginning of August, Pelosi's plane headed towards Taiwan and the visit took place, and China appeared as the weak and defeated in the face of American hegemony. And here, there's nothing left but to start live military exercises and to besiege Taiwan. But by doing so, it will also give the Americans a justification to intervene in order to break the siege of its allies. Thus, it will succeed in dragging it towards war, as it did with Russia. Here we arrive to this important question. Why does Uncle Sam's country seek to ignite the Great War again, even though the fires of war may burn everyone without exception? There's a clear intention to ignite the fire of war in the world. If we look at the events quickly, we will find an increase in conflicts between Iran and the Arabian Gulf, and supporting Iran indirectly for controlling the rest of the Arab countries after Iraq, Syria, and Yemen. On the other hand, tensions between India and Pakistan have returned again after India entered the BRICS organization and Pakistan's rebellion against the Americans. And there, on the Nile Basin, a very dangerous scheme is being implemented through the Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, especially after reaching the third filling, which means either the inevitable thirst of the Nile countries or the destruction of the dam and the occurrence of a flood. And between the two Koreas, the situation isn't better, as the North Korean leader is preparing to annex the South, like his neighbors Russia and China. On the other side of Europe, a few days after the US Secretary of State Antony Blinken's visit to Kosovo, the situation between Kosovo and Serbia has been turbulent, and today it has escalated to military clashes, which is a harbinger of a new war in Europe. And Azerbaijan again transfers heavy weapons to Karabakh, and a new crisis may erupt in the next few days. We live in days when the world is boiling and erupting. Yesterday, China warned America against playing with fire, because it would burn everyone. The countries of the world have become turbulent and ready for the Great War. And as for the clash, it's knocking on the door. Now, a questioner may ask in this situation and say, that the USA built this order, which called it the New World Order, which revolves around it within the framework of globalization. Therefore, from a theoretical point of view, if this system collapses, the US will be the biggest loser in that case, so why would it seek to destroy it? The fact that you must understand well is that this order has grown old, and is no longer profitable for the USA after it's become the direct cause of its losses, and indeed, that its collapse will cause greater losses to Uncle Sam's country, but this must be done in a way that makes other countries lose more than the US itself, as happened in World War II, when it dominated the world for 70 years. Let me brief you on facts recognized by the economic figures of America itself. Since the mid-70s, America's been consuming more than it produces, and its foreign trade deficit has been increasing, and other countries have begun to feed and clothe the USA and fuel their cars. And a questioner may ask, how so? The answer is simple. America has the largest reserves of oil, gold, and dollars in the world, and it also dominates the rest of the countries, and the prevailing law is that the weak serves the strong. However, the US Central Bank delinked the dollar to gold and began printing paper dollars by relying on petrodollars to purchase goods and raw materials from other countries around the world. And the matter later developed into printing uncovered papers as a source of hidden wealth in American money, while the external debt was constantly increasing. And with the growth of debt pyramid, the economy became in danger, and printing of uncovered paper money was also increased until the year 2008 and triggering the economic crisis in the world. This step helped with delaying the collapse of dollar, but it got the US into other trade and economic cycles, especially with China. 10 years ago, the US trade deficit with China amounted to $250 billion. But today, it has reached $450 billion. And here, printing US federal money no longer serves the US, but rather serves China. Because of this uncovered money, global inflation has increased dramatically, especially since the summer of 2020, because the Western economy in the Corona theater show entered a state of stagnation. And in order to get out of this crisis, there must be printing of twice the amount of money that is being printed now, which means that inflation will increase exponentially. Haven't you asked yourself why the measures to combat the epidemic around the world were ended, and why they allowed returning to playgrounds, prayers, cafes, and amusement parks, even though the number of infected people, according to their description, is constantly doubling? Because this game has become a blazing fire that has devoured the economy, and the dollar is actually at stake. So the magic has turned on the magician, and the USA has become suffering from a huge budget deficit with a trade deficit as well. And there isn't enough money to cover it, which I personally see the disintegration of the American economy soon. Uncle Sam's country had to turn to the policy of offerings, starting from its allies, as the only way to delay the collapse for a longer period, by plunging the world into creative chaos so that the capital from all over the world would flee to the US as the last resort for their money. On the other hand, it's getting rid of debts and competitors under the pretext of economy and stick of war. And here it is, euro is collapsing against dollar after involving Europe against Russia. And by igniting tensions over the years, more than $1 trillion from money owners in Asia, Europe, and the Arab countries were poured in the US, and demand for the US dollar has increased in a frenzy in sequence of other countries' currency collapse. This clearly indicates that global economy collapse has become very near, similar to the year 2008. However, the USA has a chance to survive by destroying all alternative centers of power in major economies, in the hope that this attempt will give it a chance to start a second hegemony, as happened in the Second World War. What Uncle Sam is playing is very dangerous, and may ignite fires we didn't even see in the previous wars. And I personally don't think that America will survive this time. Today's facts are different, the countries are more powerful, and the economy is at stake. And with all this, we see from a personal point of view that these great events represent a hard and difficult labor for the Islamic countries, but it will eventually lead to the birth of the Son of Islam again. In conclusion, always remember that there are no friends in politics, only interests, which meet today and contradict tomorrow. Don't be a party in the clash of the two poles. And don't be like a pawn on the chessboard being sacrificed off in order to achieve both players' plans. And know that siding with the Chinese-Russian alliance, as simple people do, or with the Western-American alliance is pure stupidity, as the victor among them always seeks to fight you, as it happened and happens every time.